very warm welcome to online worship for the congregation of Trinent Parish Church for this fourth Sunday of Advent and also Christmas Eve. It's good to be with you. Our call to worship comes from Psalm 89, verses 1 to 4. I will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever. With my mouth I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations. I declare that your steadfast love is established forever. Your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to my servant David. I will establish your descendants forever and build your throne for all generations. Let us worship God by singing, O Little Town of Bethlehem. Let us pray. Lord and Creator of the world, God of dreams and visions, of angels and the interruption of unexpected voices and new insight. This Christmas Eve, we remember Mary and Joseph. We give thanks for their openness and their trust in you. We give thanks for their faithfulness, their courage and obedience, for they stepped out into the unknown in the strength of your spirit, and they played their part in your plan to bring your people back to you. Loving Lord, we pray that their example might be the pattern of our lives, that when your voice reaches us, breaking through the noise of this world and into our small corner, that we may be ready to listen and to act. We ask this, Lord, because we know that at times we fail you. You ask for repentance and we are often too complacent. You ask for service and we are often too busy. We are sorry, Lord, that we do little for you in return for what you do for us. Yet, Lord, we know that you are a loving and merciful God. We trust in your forgiveness. May we, like Mary, be your willing servants and care for others as Jesus did too. And we now pray together in his name and in the words that he taught us to pray, in whichever words are most familiar to each one of us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Murdo MacDonald is reading our Bible lesson for us this Christmas Eve.
Our Old Testament reading this morning is from the book of Psalms, Psalm 89, reading from verses 1 to 4. God's covenant with David. Psalm 89, reading from 1 to 4. I will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever. With my mouth I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations. I declare that your steadfast love is established forever. Your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to my servant David, I will establish your descendants forever and build your throne for all generations. Amen. And our New Testament reading this morning is from the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 1, reading from verses 26 to 38. The birth of Jesus foretold. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, Greetings, favoured one, the Lord is with you. But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favour with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary said to the angel, How can this be, since I am a virgin? The angel said to her, The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her, who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God. Then Mary said, Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word. Then the angel departed from her. Amen.
Our next hymn is Love Came Down at Christmas.
Thank you.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you, Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. It is Christmas Eve, and I hope that we are all ready for Christmas and that all the decorations are done, all the food shopping bought, all the preparations made. And I wonder if you have a nativity which you put up each year at home. The one I had as a child was made out of a cardboard shoebox with little paper figures and gold ribbon cut in strips for the thatch of the stable. And I now have one made of wooden figures with no colour, they are no faces and no stable, and they are free to find a new home each year. And then we have something different again in our church. We have the large knitted puppets, which you can see just waiting there beside me. That's what we do with the Christmas story, though, isn't it? It's so familiar, and yet the invitation each year is to reimagine it in different ways. The reading from Luke is simple and to the point. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. That's all we get. So we are invited to magnify it, as it were, to expand the story, to look at the background, the context which anchors it and held it in place at the time it was written, but also to look at the things which anchor it to our times too, to our lives and to the reality of today. The account was written by Luke between about 85 and 96 AD, perhaps in the city of Antioch, long after Jesus' birth and his death and his resurrection. And so this is a story written looking backwards, after the ending is already known. But let's start firstly with the beginning, as the lesson does, with the power of the state. It sets the background to the story. And it's a background of Roman power. At this time, the Roman Empire spread from Scotland to Egypt. And we can think of the power which ruled the Mediterranean and Western Europe for six centuries. The Romans were a nation of soldiers, and there was the Roman peace which the empire established, the Pax Romana. And their emperors were supreme generals of a Rome where slavery was an integral part of the way of life. There was law and order, but oppression too, and for Israel that meant occupation. Gaius Octavius ruled as Caesar or emperor at the time of Jesus' birth, and he became called Augustus, or revered, hailed as the Son of God. And registration was a method of Roman control, especially for paying taxes and for conscription. It was a way of keeping track of people, making sure that they complied with the rules which kept the Romans in power. And so Joseph and Mary need to be registered. Compulsory registration for control is pertinent to us today too. In October next year, Britons travelling to European Union countries will need to have their fingerprints registered and their picture taken with a new entry-exit system. All non-EU passport holders will need to follow this, and the system is to track arrivals and departures, and to make sure that people don't stay too long. So the power of the state is always with us. For the story of Christmas, the place of registration is important too. For Mary and Joseph travel to Bethlehem, and that is no mistake. Bethlehem is the birthplace of King David, and Micah the prophet said that the future ruler would be born there. So the town was famous because of its connection to King David, and Joseph was a descendant of David, and it was important to the Christmas story for there to be a sign of Jesus' link to this king who was chosen by God. The inn they come to is likely to have been simply a temporary place for travellers to stay in, a simple shelter to protect people from the cold of the night. And yet, Bethlehem was not an important place in Jesus' time. It was on the western edge of the Judean desert and the Judean wilderness. But in all ages, it had been a place of welcome for those coming in from the wilderness. The background to the story is the power of the state, the importance of place in its royal history, and then thirdly, in contrast, behind these brief details is the reality of human birth. Behind the brief description is the difficulty and the struggle and the pain involved in giving birth, and the risk too with the uncertain outcome. But covering all this is the simplicity of the circumstances. Luke has told us that Mary is favored by God and she has been blessed by Elizabeth, and yet the story says he went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. She is, in this story, a young girl with no status, no special knowledge, no skills that we know of, giving birth to her first baby in a strange place in makeshift circumstances by necessity. It is a simple and a down-to-earth story, which is what shines through and which is what continues with the story of the shepherds in the fields simply doing their work, protecting the animals, patiently watching and keeping awake. If we look behind the bare facts, we can see that the Roman peace was not a true peace. It could not be, because it was founded on violence and incorporated slavery. It demanded that Mary and Joseph make that difficult journey at such an inconvenient time for them to register. It demanded that they made a journey away from family and towards strangers. And yet, with them, we can see the true peace, the wonder of a simple human and yet divine birth, open to all. The shepherds heard the angels sing, "On earth, peace among those whom he favours." Jesus, the baby and the man of peace, was put to death by the power of violence, but he was never controlled or deflected or changed by it. He defeated it. That peace, that holiness which shines from the story back then, that which was found then, can be found in our lives now when we come close to him. The Nativity story is not simply back then, held forever in a time far away from our own and a culture different to our own, because it is always escaping to become our story too. Living as we do, in an imperfect world where many lives are controlled and dominated and limited by hurt and violence, we can always reach out and embrace the deep peace which Jesus brings, which covers all his people, each day and every day, and not just at Christmas, in holy moments. Like those shepherds in the fields, when we are doing what we usually do, we can take time to stop, to look up, to wonder at the mystery and the beauty of God breaking into our world, coming down to earth. May that heavenly peace come and surround you too, and those you love, this Christmas. Amen. Our next hymn is, "Lord, You Are Rich Beyond All Splendor."
Thank you.
Prayer for dedication of our offering. Let us pray. Lord God, you give us the lasting gift of your love, which stays steady and unwavering. The light of it never goes out. We gather round it in worship. It warms us and shows us the path to life. Bless our offering today, Lord, that it may warm and strengthen those in need. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our prayers of thanksgiving and for others. Let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks for family, friends, and strangers. We give you thanks for the hope that lives in each Advent, of a love that has no end. We give you thanks that you watch over us and are with us this Christmas Eve. And we thank you too for the excitement and anticipation of Christmas Day and for the gift of heaven breaking into earth with the birth of your Son. In our prayers for others and the world, Lord, we pray for peace. We pray for peace in those parts of the world torn apart by war and injustice. And we pray for Ukraine, Israel and Palestine, Syria, Yemen, Afghanistan and Sudan. We pray for peace and justice to rule the hearts of those who have it in their power to bring change and reconciliation. And we pray for healing and justice for all who are suffering the loss of home, health, and hope. For the angel said that nothing will be impossible with you. Loving Lord, we pray for our fragile and beautiful earth, that we may break free from the greed and selfishness of this time, and that we will grow in our love and our care for her, and be a people willing to make sacrifices to care for creation. Loving God, we pray for our church, that we will always rejoice in your stories and find new ways of telling them and sharing them with a world so greatly in need of your message. Loving Father, we pray for all who need your protection and care, for those who are grieving, for those who are ill, for those who struggle with life, and for those who are finding the extra pressures which this season can bring difficult to bear. We pray that the elderly may know comfort and care, and that the young may know wonder and hope in life. We pray for those who are lonely and homeless, and for the work of our winter hub, that it may be a place of warmth and welcome this winter. Lord, this Christmas Eve, you bring us light and love. May your light and love spread throughout the world. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our final hymn is Once in Royal David's City. May you go from this time of worship in peace and love to serve the Lord this Christmas Eve. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest on you and remain on you and on all those you love and pray for today, now and even forevermore. Amen.